Amen, amen. Our scripture for today will be taken from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. I want to take this opportunity while you're turning there, say thank you to our praise team this morning. Thank you to our Mass choir. This is Mass choir. Yeah. Everybody joining together. That's what the body of Christ looks like. Everybody working together. I feel good all in my soul. Seems like y'all have some more words. Like I feel good all well on down. You know, something like that. Amen. 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Will you now rest on your feet for the reading of God's word? From the New King James Version of the Bible, the word of God reads, "And it came to pass, when the Lord was about to take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. Then Elijah said to Elisha, 'Stay here, please, for the Lord has sent me on to Bethel.' But Elisha said, 'As the Lord lives, and as your soul lives, I will not leave you.' So they went down to Bethel. Now the sons of the prophets who were at Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, 'Do you know that the Lord will take away your master from over you today?' And he said, 'Yes, I know. Keep silent.' Then Elijah said to him, 'Elisha, stay here, please, for the Lord has sent me on to Jericho.' But he said, 'As the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you.' So they came to Jericho." Let us pray. Father, we thank you for a journey of life. We thank you, God, for the manifestation of your Spirit. We thank you, Father, for the example you give us in the prophets. This time you've been showing us an example of power, and God, I pray that we would all learn to walk in power. Today, Father, we ask very humbly that you would allow your Spirit to work through me for your glory, that this body of Christ will be edified, and you, Holy Father, will be glorified. I need you, God, to direct this message this morning. So I yield and I thank you. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of God. And I'd like to thank our ushers this morning for your service. And we're bringing to an end our series on the prophet Elijah, Soul on Fire. Have you noticed that with these messages, there's been some fire in just about every message? Something about Elijah and fire. In fact, he got really good with that fire and started. If you read his life story, read in 1 Kings, you'll see that there are some other miracles he performed that were just amazing. He was a very, very powerful prophet. In the first week, when we were talking about Elijah, we found that he stepped on the scene and he prayed that it would not rain and the brook dried up. And he stepped on the scene because there was a king named Ahab and his wife Jezebel that were leading Israel astray. And the nation needed a change. Tell your neighbor, we need a change. Yeah, we really do. We need a change. We all need our own personal changes. Amen. Because we're not perfect. Thank God we're not what we used to be. But there's still a ways to go. Amen? Amen? So he defied the evil and the brook dried up. And then in the second week, we find that after 3.5 years, he challenged the prophets of Baal. And through this challenge, he called on God, and God rained down fire from heaven. And it was during that time that we see a very powerful move of God in a moment when people needed to see what was going on. And there comes a time for all of us when we are going to to make change happen, and others are going to see it. But just remember, not everybody is happy about your change. Amen? There's always some naysayers and some talebearers. You know what a talebearer is, right? That's a person who takes a tale and they bear it. They take it up and they carry it somewhere. It's a talebearer. They're always telling stories about folk. But we'll talk about them in another sermon. Amen? Amen. All right. Well, last week, Elijah was running for his life, and he ended up in a cave because Jezebel sent word that she was going to kill him. And the Lord asked him a single question. He asked, "What are you doing here?" Ask your neighbor, "What are you doing here?" Now, neighbor, don't you answer that. But we all need to answer that question. We need to say, "What are we doing here? What's our purpose? What's our goal? What's our focus?" And I will tell you right now, if your focus is anything other than Jesus Christ, if your focus is anything other than worshiping God, if your focus is anything other than honoring God for all that he has done in your life, then your focus is misplaced. And you need to work on that. Amen? But there, the Lord strengthened him, and he strengthened his relationship with God. There was a wind, and there was fire, and there was earthquake, but the Lord was not in any of those. He was in a still, small voice. So we fast forward it now, and we're at the end of Elijah's life. We're at this time where his earthly ministry is coming to an end. And this, I guess you could say, devastatingly powerful prophet of God is going to go home soon. How many of you know all of us are going to go home one day? We're just traveling. We're just passing through this way. But one of these days, all of us are going home. He has fought a good fight. He has kept the faith. And he knows that the Lord is coming for him. He has sparked change in a time when change was desperately needed. But he's not alone. Elijah is not alone because while he was in that cave, the Lord spoke to him and said, "You need to anoint Elisha to be prophet in your stead." Elijah, this man of destiny, this man of power, this man whose soul was on fire, must now leave a legacy. And today, that's really what I want to talk about. I want to talk about how we can, our change makes us leave a legacy. We've got to leave a legacy. Amen? So let's go look at verse 5. This is 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 5. First thing I want you to know is that you can't run from your legacy. You can't run from your legacy. Now I know we're using this word legacy, but let me say this to our young people. You're leaving a legacy as well. You just don't know it yet. You know, most of us, when we get older, we begin to think about, you know, our children and children's children and think about legacy. But young people, we're leaving a legacy as well. So the scripture says, "Now the sons of the prophets who were at Jericho came to Elisha and said to him, 'Do you know that the Lord will take away your master from over you today?' So he answered, 'Yes, I know. Keep silent.' Then Elijah said to him, 'Stay here, please, for the Lord has sent me on to Jordan.' But he said, 'As the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you.' So the two of them went on." In Bethel, in Jericho, and even heading on his way to Jordan, everybody's telling Elisha that Elijah is going to leave him. "Do you not know that your master is going to leave from over you today?" People are talking about it, and while they're talking to Elisha about it, Elijah is also trying to leave him behind. He said, "You know, you just stay here. I need to go on somewhere else." And Elisha just keeps refusing. He says, "I'm not leaving your side." He says, "As your soul lives, I will not leave you." He is determined to stay with Elijah to the very end. Let me tell you something. We were never meant to live this Christian life alone. We were never meant to walk this road alone. We were never expected to work this faith alone. We should reap the benefit of belonging to each other. We belong to one another. And though we may try to be private, and though we may try to keep things to ourselves, the truth is, people are still watching us.
And God is still putting us in a position where people can see us walk out our faith. The truth is, for all of us, we need to understand, we're not the only ones who were called. Did you hear that? I was called. Brother Spoon was called. Sister Baker was called. Buddy was called. All of us, we were called by the same God to have a relationship with him. It doesn't matter who you are. Though you may not hold an office, you know, like Reverend Jackson and I, you're still called by God, and you are called individually to be a part of the collective, that we will all be together. Elijah was called, and then he was commissioned by God, so was Elisha. We're not the only person in the church who has the ability that we have. And none of us should begin to think that we are so singularly important that we can't be replaced. We're not the only person who has the qualifications to do whatever is being done in the church. I say to you all the time, one monkey doesn't stop God's show. Because if God can't use a monkey, he'll use an orangutan. He'll use something else, you know. It doesn't matter that it's us or we can't take everything that we've learned with us. Listen to me. You cannot take everything that you've learned with you. You cannot take all the years of experience with you. You need to be sharing that with somebody else in the body of Christ. There should be a constant feeder system of people who are being grown in the church who understand what you understand and are anointed to do what you're anointed to do. We can't leave without training somebody else. Doesn't matter how long you've been in church. There's going to come a day when you're going to have to step down. Doesn't matter how long you serve. There's going to come a day when maybe in that position you no longer have the authority. It doesn't matter how well you sing, there's going to come a day your voice will be missing. It doesn't matter how long you organize the finances, God is going to raise up somebody else to carry on when you're gone. Tell your neighbor, you can't be a closet Christian. Why? Because there's somebody following you. There's always somebody following you. Jesus said it this way. Jesus said, a city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. And whether you realize it or not, I know some of us like to duck and dodge. I do it sometimes. Listen, I'm not going to talk about you. I'm talking about me. Okay? Sometimes when I come to Tuskegee and I'm, you know, it's not Sunday, and I'm wearing like maybe a t-shirt and a pair of shorts, I know that half of you don't recognize me. And so I can duck and dodge, and I can know that I'm not going to run into anybody at the church. But then again, it's kind of fun to run into you because you look at me kind of shocked when some stranger, comes up and speaks to you in the store, you know, and then you look surprised. But sometimes we like to duck and dodge in our faith. We like to duck and dodge because we don't want everybody to know what we're doing. We don't want them to know how we're living. We don't want them to really see us or to notice us. But the truth is, all of us are sitting up on a hill. We can't distance ourselves from the church just because we don't want everybody in our business. Let me tell you the truth. If you would allow the church to be in your business, maybe your business would get straight. Maybe there would be somebody in the church who can encourage you to do right when you continue to do wrong. Maybe there's somebody in the church who can hold you accountable. We don't want anybody to see our embarrassing side. You know, the part that we don't really want to tell anyone, but I tell you from experience, I love it when somebody is able to pull my coattail and say, you were wrong.
That's right.
Or someone is able to look at me and say, you can do better. I have that happen all the time. My wife does it. She's like, no, you gotta fix that. And I'm just sitting there embarrassed, and then I get up and I fix it. I'm just telling the fellas I do that. The truth is, none of us are anonymous, none of us are incognito. And those who have a separatist attitude in the church are missing out on the blessing of fellowship. We're forfeiting the blessing of being with the saints. Tell your neighbor, you can't be a closet Christian. You can't just shake off your legacy. People are gleaning things from you. You can't prove, did you realize you can't even prove your faith alone? Did you know that? said the mark of a disciple, this is how people are going to know you're my disciple. He said, by the way you love one another, not by the way you love yourself. You can't even prove that you're a disciple of Jesus Christ by yourself. Brother Janet, prove that you're a disciple by yourself. He laughed at me and shook his head. You cannot prove that you're a child of God alone. You have to do it with other people. Do you know you can't fulfill the word of God alone? Did you know that? Jesus said all of the word of God is fulfilled. All of it is fulfilled in love your God and love your neighbor as yourself, which means you've got to find a neighbor to love in order for you to even fulfill what Scripture has outlined for you. You can't produce fruit by yourself. You know, some of us talk about, you know, we love everybody, but you're never around anybody. Well, how does anybody know about this fruit you have? Well, you know, I forgive everybody. No, no, you just stop calling them when you got mad. Yeah. And you're calling it forgiveness. Jesus says, apart from him, you cannot produce fruit. You can't even produce fruit alone. You can't display the gifts of the Spirit alone. You can't grow alone. He said, go and make disciples. It requires us to be with somebody else. You cannot leave behind your legacy. You cannot run from who God has called you to be and who God is using you to help somebody else become who they're supposed to be. Why? Because we rise and we fall together. Why? Because we are told to bear one another's burdens. Why? Because we rejoice with those who rejoice and we weep with those who weep. We look out for each other. We work in the vineyard together. We make memories together. And we should be working on making memories together. Amen? If one of us falls, another one should be picking us up. If one gets sick, another one should pray for him. If one is lacking, then another should be blessing. And if one is blessing, then somebody else ought to be blessing them as well. We are intertwined with one another. One of us waters, one of us plants, God grants the increase. One preaches and another is edified. One grieves and another comforts. You can't run from your legacy because it's being built in the way you live every day. Which is what I want to tell you next. Build your legacy daily. Build your legacy daily. Let's look at verses 7 and 8. And 50 men of the sons of the prophets went and stood facing them at a distance, while the two of them stood by the Jordan. Now Elijah took his mantle, rolled it up, and struck the water, and it was divided this way and that, so that the two of them crossed over on dry ground. A miracle has just happened. The Jordan River has just been split. Elijah takes off his mantle, which is his cloak, his overcloak. Some scholars believe that's the only garment he had because it's the only garment that they refer to. And it's usually the kind of thing that is hairy. By definition, it's hairy. So it may have been a sheepskin. He takes it off, he rolls it up, and he smacks the Jordan River, and it just parts, and they go across on dry land. Do you know when that happened? Elisha was watching. Let me share something a little more practical with you. It's Father's Day, and this is my father. My father passed away back in 2010, but I learned so much from him. Now he wasn't always around. He and my mother were separated, and I would go spend weeks with him during the summer and spend weekends with him throughout the year at other times. But see, here's the thing about my father. He was very deliberate about teaching everything he could when we were together. I recollect and I think that when I was with my dad, it was classes in session. Always. We walk into a store, he's teaching me things. We go to someone's house, he's teaching me things. We're riding in the car, he's teaching me things. He's constantly teaching me. He taught me how to make barbecue sauce. And I like barbecue. He taught me how to drive. He taught me how to catch and throw a baseball. You may not know this. My dad played sports left-handed. So I know how to actually use a baseball glove to throw and catch right or left-handed. because my dad taught that to me. He taught me how to speak to people. You know how you greet people, you say hello. He's always telling me, you know, son, look people in the eye, shake the hand, give them a firm handshake. You know, all these little lessons he's given me throughout life. He taught me how to throw a good spiral. He taught me how to make banana pudding, y'all. I'm telling you, my dad made great banana pudding. He even taught me how to make, and I don't know if my wife knows this or not, but he taught me how to make pecan pie. Yes, he did. And he taught me about tools, and he taught me how to tie a necktie. And there are countless examples, but there's other things that I learned just by watching. I learned how to carry myself. Sometimes even when I'm riding in the car, I'll move my hand a certain way, and I'll say, wow, it looks just like my dad. Because he would carry himself, the way he moved, his mannerisms. I was picking up all this. I picked up one thing from my dad just watching him, just how to show kindness. My dad would come home from work. He worked at a grocery store. He would come home from work, and he'd have bags full of groceries. And he'd be taking those groceries to his neighbors. You know, hey, they were going to get rid of these bananas. Y'all going to make banana pudding. He was an advocate for banana pudding, okay? You know, they were going to, you know, we had some meat that went on sale. It's, you know, I went ahead and picked it up for you. He was constantly taking something to somebody else. I learned about watching him how to never meet a stranger. I can hold a conversation with anyone. It doesn't matter who they are, where they're from, even if there's a language barrier. My dad would somehow find a way to have a conversation with someone. He would talk to me, and he, you know, he never went to college or anything, but he had friends that were doctors and lawyers, and he would talk with them and talk about what they were doing in their lives. I learned by watching him. I learned even how to respect the word of God by watching my father. And he even taught me some other things when I was watching. He taught me what not to do, because they were revealed in his mistakes. And he never withheld his faults from me. And he never hid his failures from me. He let me know I made a mistake in this part of my life. I did something wrong here, and I don't want you to do the same. I learned by watching just as much as I learned by doing. Whether he realized it or not, I was always watching him. Elisha is learning from Elijah the same way. We're at the end of Elijah's life, but you have to understand, Elisha had been walking with him a long time. Elisha had learned from him how to hear from God. Elisha learned from Elijah how to follow God's instructions. But when the Lord is telling Elijah, I'm going from this town to that town, Elisha was having that same understanding, and that's how you know where to go, by listening to God. He knew how to be a leader to all of the other prophets because he learned from Elijah. Elisha was showing Elisha how to talk to kings and how to deal with rulers. And when you read Elisha's life, when he has a conversation with Ahab, it sounds just like Elijah's having a conversation with Ahab. These are all the normal activities of everyday life for this prophet. Elijah was building a legacy in Elisha day by day. And whether you realize it or not, they're doing the same thing. People are watching you. I know that makes some of you feel uncomfortable, but people are watching you. Every time you serve in this church, somebody's watching you. And you're building a legacy in that person because they see what service is supposed to look like. Every time you live righteously and you make good decisions and other people see that, you're showing them. You're building a legacy inside of them. Every time you exercise your faith, some of us have had to exercise our faith in some very powerful ways. We have faced some mountains that we didn't know we could climb, and we made it over, and we came back to church, and we said, Lord, thank you that we made it, and guess what? Other people heard you when you said it. They saw the praise on your lips when you came and you got over cancer. They saw the praise on your lips when your house wasn't foreclosed on. They saw all the praise on your lips when God blessed you with that new job or that new opportunity. People are watching you, and you're building a legacy of faith in them in your everyday life. Every every time you humble yourself before God, every time you step up to defend the weak, every time you give, and every time you pray, and every time you praise one way or another, you're going to leave a legacy. We just had Vacation Bible School this week, and in Vacation Bible School, I saw it in action. I remember 18, you know, almost 20 years ago, coming to Vacation Bible School at Greater Friendship, and you know what? There's a whole new generation that's working on Vacation Bible School. There are kids who used to be in the elementary class who are now teaching the elementary class. There are kids who weren't even born who watch other people be secretary, and now they're the secretary. We're finding that folks were stepping up, and they didn't have to have so much of a great instruction manual because they were watching us all along. They were already watching what we were doing. The question is, what will you leave behind? That brings me to the last one. Leave a worthy legacy. Leave a worthy legacy. Let's read a few verses. This is verse 9. And so it was when they had crossed over that Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask what may I do for you before I am taken away from you." Elisha said, "Please let a double portion of your spirit be upon me." So he said, "You have asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if you see me when I am taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if not, it shall not be so." Then it happened as they continued on and talked that suddenly a chariot of fire, there's that fire again, a chariot of fire appeared with horses of fire and separated the two of them, and Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it. And he cried out, my father, the chariot of Israel and his horsemen. So he saw him no more, and he took hold of his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. He also took up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and went back and stood by the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water and said, "Where is the Lord God of Elijah?" And when he also had struck the water, it was divided this way and that, and Elisha crossed over. Now when the sons of the prophets who were from Jericho saw him, they said, "The spirit of Elijah rests on Elisha." And they came to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. I'm going to be taken away from you. What do you want? You know what? I want a double portion of your spirit. Well, if you see me when I go, then you can have it. And then a chariot of fire and horses of fire shows up, and Elijah is taken away. Now, understand. Elijah has been given a great honor. Think about this. Elijah didn't die. Only Enoch, in the book of Genesis, Elijah and Jesus, when Jesus was taken to heaven in a cloud, those are the only three people in the Bible who did not, well, Jesus actually tasted death, but they did not die and remain. He was taken and transformed to be in the courts of the Lord. Literally taken by God. But when he went away, he left something that was very important. He left not only the legacy and the examples of the things he had done, he left his mantle. And that's important because in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit did not dwell inside of people. The Holy Spirit rested on people. It was the New Testament where we were promised by God that he would put his spirit inside of us. So the Spirit of God was on Elijah during his life, and the Spirit of God rested on that mantle. And when Elisha took the mantle, that same power, that same authority was given to him. He didn't ask for twice as much. Now, he asked for a double portion. It doesn't mean he was asking for twice as much power as Elijah. What he was asking for was the son's portion. You see, when there was an inheritance left behind, if there were three children, the son got the first oldest son got a double portion. He asked for a double portion of his spirit. He asked for the ability to have more of the presence of God than the other prophets, because he knew that he was walking in Elijah's shoes and he would need to be the leader of the prophets. He coveted the best gift. He coveted and he longed for the best that Elijah could give him. Fathers, I want to tell you that when we watch you, and even for believers who are not fathers, when we watch you, we want to see your best. We want the best part of you. We want our heroes to stand up for us and do something miraculous. My son still talks today, even though, listen, my knees won't let me do it. But he still talks today about that one time we played basketball. And that one move I did that one day. Because he wants to believe in his heart, my dad plays the ball. And I get out there now, y'all be able to call handles. But he remembers the best thing. He remembers those things and he holds on to those things where he saw me at my best. One of the things that was amazing was interesting when my father passed, and even after my mother-in-law passed, we were riding in the car. And he said to me, "Dad, you're probably the strongest man I've ever met. For you to lose people so close to you, take care of their affairs, perform their eulogies, and do what you can to hold our family together," he's like, "You're like Superman." I say that because I want you to know, gentlemen, when we talk about you, and we talk about the things we see in you, we talk about the best. We talk about the times that you showed up for us. We talk about the times you stood up for us. And not everybody has done it. Not everybody has given their best. You know there's a song about it. It says Papa was a Rolling Stone. Wherever he laid his hat was his home. And when he was gone, all he left us was alone. But I pray that God will use you to leave something better. That you will have a better testimony, a better legacy that you have poured into us. What will you leave behind? Ask your neighbor, what will you leave behind? Will you leave encouragement? Will somebody remember how you encouraged them? Or will you leave discouragement? What will you leave behind? Will you show us an example of selflessness, or will we remember you for always being so selfish? Will you leave behind a legacy of faithfulness, or will we know that you hardly ever believed God and tried to do everything in your own strength and showed us faithlessness? Will you leave behind giving or grudging? Will you leave behind blessings or curses? Will you leave behind solutions, or will you be the one that always brought the problems? What will you leave behind? Will you leave behind trust or mistrust? Will it be unity or discord? Will you always war it with everybody? Or were you the one who had the audacity and the courage to use your own power, strength, and resources to build bridges, to put relationships back together again? Will you leave integrity? Will you leave a life, a legacy of prayer? Will we remember hearing you pray? Will we remember seeing you pray? Or will we always just remember the complaints? Will we remember that you, regardless of how people looked at you and thought that you had to be a man, that you stood up and you gave God the praise anyhow, no matter how silly you may have looked? Or will they remember that you were the one that was always silent? Will you leave behind wisdom or ignorance? Will you be the one we remember who edified, or will you be the one that always tore down? Will you leave behind a mantle of power? Something that we can pick up. Something that we can carry in our daily lives. Something that will make us stronger. I want to be able to say at the end of my life that hopefully somebody saw something in me that will make them say what Elisha said. He just asked the question, where is the God of Elijah? I want somebody in their darkest hour who doesn't really know a lot about God to remember me talking about God and say, where is the God of River Emmanuel? Where is the God that he always talked about? Where is the God that he always showed me? Where is that God that that deacon was always praying about? Where is the God that that choir was always singing about? Where is the God that calls people who wanted to come and serve and do and give up their time and their energy and their talents? Where is that God? Where is the God? The one that the worshipers worship, the one that made us husbands and fathers. Where is that God you always told me about? Because they can't see God with a naked eye, but they can see him working in you and us, you and I. They can see him working in us. Well, where is he? Where is he? I'll tell you where he is. He dwells in the temple of your soul. He's seated on the altar of your heart. He's walking ahead of you every day of your life, ordering your steps. He's even by your side, giving you guidance. He's walking behind you with goodness and mercy that shall follow you all the days of your life. He's beneath you, providing a firm foundation for you to stand on. And he's above you, showering down his blessings on your life. He's in your past, saving your soul. He's in your present, saving your life. He's in your future, and he's making a place for you. Where is the God of Elijah? I know that he's alive and well. Somebody tell me, where is the God of Elijah? I've got some problems that I need to be able to roll up a mantle, and I need to be able to smite it and watch it split from one side to the other. I've got some struggles in my life that have held me down, and I need to be able to pick up somebody's mantle, somebody who's already made it through the struggle, and they can show me how to get there. I need the God of Elijah. I need the God that I've seen over and over and over again. The God that healed you, I need him to heal me. The God that delivered you, I need him to deliver me. Pass along your legacy. Don't keep it to yourself. Let me know what God has done for you. Let me know how God has blessed you. What he's done for you, I'm sure he can do it for me. Where is this God you keep talking about? Where is this God you keep singing about? I need a double punch. I've got a lot of trouble in my life. I don't need a little bit. I need a double point. If my life is going to change, I need the God of Elijah. I need the God who will set my soul on fire. Jesus Christ came into this world just like Elijah, and he changed it. He changed the entire world. And the legacy that he left behind is you and I. We are still reaping the blessing of what God did through Jesus Christ. The question is, what will you do with it? What will you leave behind for those who are coming behind you? I pray that they see you bright and shining. I pray that they see you faithful and committed. I pray that they look at you and one day they'll catch a glimpse of maybe even just an ember. It doesn't take a lot, just an ember. Maybe just a faint glow of a light that they will know. I thought she was crazy for praising God like she did. But I realize now her soul was on fire. I thought that he was crazy for coming over to the church all the time and serving and helping. And wasn't nobody paying that joker either. He still went over there. He wasn't crazy. His soul was on fire. I know I don't always get it when I read the Bible, but he was studying so much and kept talking about the mysteries of God. And I didn't understand it, and I thought there was something wrong with him. But the truth is, his soul was on fire. That's what we pray to see in you, for your service to God and the life you live in the Spirit. God bless you.